Hey programmers, this time we're covering all the differences in your sequences from grandMA2 to grandMA3. The biggest difference is how the software fundamentally treats the sequences. In grandMA2, the executors had a lot of ownership over the sequences settings, but on grandMA3, the sequences themselves own everything. Sequences still live in the sequence pool, but when you assign it to multiple executors, it's more like a preset reference, so the sequence plays everywhere at the same time. You can also see what queue it's in on the sequence in the pool. This is the first departure from MA2, where we could have had the same sequence playing on one executor and be totally off on another executor. If that was something that you used often, don't worry, you're not out of luck. MA has built in another option for you that we'll cover later in this video. When we want to see our queue list, we're going to look for sequence in the add window option. It's no longer sequence executor because the executor is just a playback tool now, and the sequence will be the same anywhere you put it. Let's make a really simple look. I'm just going to take some lights to full, give them a position preset and a color preset. We haven't talked about creating presets yet, so I'm just using the presets available in the demo show. Obviously, I've got my fixture sheet open because I want to see what I'm doing and what values I'm storing. When I'm ready to store, I could store this directly to an executor, which also stores the sequence here in my sequence pool. Now, I could choose to store this to the sequence pool directly and then later assign it to an executor hardware, or never assign it to an executor. I can choose to playback my sequences from this pool directly if I want. For the most part, I like to have the flexibility of the executor hardware, but I could see myself leaving some sequences, maybe stuff like chases or simple hits that are being triggered by other cues in my main sequence, here in the pool to free up my executors. I'm going to play that cue back and also clear out my fixture sheet so that this look is being controlled by playback. All familiar. We probably want to see the cue list in our sequence sheet now, so we need to select it. We can do just like MA2 and select our executor, or now you can select your sequence in the pool. Already, there's a couple new things you can see, just in the name column. Instead of the cue being called Q1, the default is to name it after our presets, but of course, we can change this. There's also markers in the name cell. Light red indicates relative values in the queue, green means more than one fade time, while orange means more than one delay time. A cyan marker indicates the presence of a preset, and that magenta-ish color indicates a phaser. You might have noticed this off queue at the end of the sequence. Just because it's at the end, it doesn't mean that if I play through my sequence and hit go when I'm in the last queue that the sequence gets turned off. This is just a place where you can set the off time for your sequence. You can set fade or delay information as an overall value, or go in and set different times for different features. And while I'm on the topic of off, let's double tap the off key to see our off menu. Still shows my running playback like MA2, and I've got options at the bottom that we remember like all sequences off and everything off. If I want to see running objects besides sequences, I can come up to the title bar and switch to macros or timecode. Switching this option will also update your option at the bottom of the screen. Let's add in a second queue. And good news, our options are the same in the pop-up that we remember all the way back to grandMA1. So not surprisingly, I'm hitting create second queue. And because I want to see the transition, I'm clearing out my programmer and then pressing go plus. I'm not going to cover stuff like go plus, go minus, etc. because they're the same as MA2. Instead, I want to refer back to those programmer parts that we covered in the last tutorial. We saw how the programmer parts window was a visual way to see how we could lay out part queues. So for this next queue, let's put our position change in part 0 and lower our intensity in part 1. Next, store this as our next queue. We can see our two parts here in the sequence sheet, with the first part having the name of the position, and the part with our intensity queue, which I'm going to relabel, below. After I clear out, when I hit go, these two parts are triggered at the same time. Remember, they're parts of a whole queue, not follow queues. If part queues are new for you, here's one way you might get some benefit from them. Since each part has its own line in the sheet, it's super easy for me now to change delay or fade time on one of these parts without affecting the other. Like, maybe I change the movement to a 1 count, but the intensity fade to a 5. And like I said before, you don't have to do these things in part cues. It's just another option. I could absolutely have left this as a single cue and just edited the timing on the individual parameters to get the same thing. It's just another style they're offering you. There's also some automation of this that you can do with your presets, so we'll come back to this concept in the preset tutorial. Now that we have a few cues and parts in the sequence, let's look more at this window. There's a lot that should be familiar, like all of the timing and transition options. We can still trigger commands from cues, and just like before, we still have our cue triggers. But there's new stuff too, like this lock option. Turning on a lock for a cue prevents unwanted edits. Another new cell is duration, which is just showing you the completion time of the cue based on all of the various fade and delay times applied. Release and assert will be covered in our next tutorial with more detail and some examples, but for now, know that both of these columns will affect only your tracked values and how they're played back. Another new column is allow duplicates. If this is set to yes, then you can use the same attribute in multiple parts of the same cue. Normally, we can only store one value to an attribute in a cue. Using this allow duplicates gives us the option of multiple values, so we could theoretically have multiple looks in a single cue with multiple parts if you were to delay out the timing of one of those parts. If you ever wrote a cue with one value on an attribute, then a second cue with a different value on that same attribute, and you set a trigger time on that second cue, it's basically the same thing. I think what the larger benefit will be is for phasers. With this on, you could start overlapping phasers and get a completely different look. Sync and morph also come into play when you have multiple phasers running in a queue. We'll come back to all the phaser options when we get to the phaser tutorial. We'll also come back to tracking distance, but much sooner. That's part of the next tutorial. If you're using the demo show, you might not be seeing the MIB options in your sheet. If that's the case, go into the settings options and under mask, make sure MIB is on. Okay, then if you have a cue that could potentially benefit from a little move in black action, you can start with a mode column. The options here are pretty familiar from MA2, and if you choose defined, you can use the target column to set a specific cue number. Defined is very specific and also won't care at all if you've set an MIB preference on a cue. For example, check out these options. I could say that a cue is anywhere from best to never as far as a possible moment for a move in black to happen. I love all these labels, but I do kind of wish that they had gone with awesome instead of best, and maybe nope instead of worst, but that's just me. But again, remember that these options will only be used if you have a mode on a future cue like early or late. Like I said, defined will not care if you set this cue to nope. Worst. The multi-step has to do with phasers. Should the effects start running as part of the MIB setup, or should they stay paused until the intensity is brought up? The last two columns allow us to set fade and delay times on our MIB setup attributes. Settings in the top toolbar are the sequence settings that you might remember as being part of the assign functions of a sequence on an executor in MA2. Since everything lives with the sequence and not the hardware, options like auto start and stop, priorities, tracking, and more can be set here, and they'll follow to any executor you might assign this sequence to. Of course, there were times when we were programming grandMA2 where having different settings on the same sequence based on a different executor was handy. So what MA has done on the 3 is they've added what's called mirror sequences, and I kind of like to think of these as sort of like an embedded sequence. If I assign this original sequence to a new tile in the sequence pool, it's like I've just created a copy of my sequence, but if I make a change to the programming on that original sequence, that change will also be reflected in the mirrored sequence. And if I'm working with the mirrored sequence and make changes, it will also be stored in the original sequence. Programming-wise, they should always be the same contents. Where you can diverge is within the settings. So I could assign this mirror to another executor and switch those settings up however I like. You'll know you've got a mirrored sequence anytime you see this icon in the pool. As far as making changes to existing queues, we can still use a syntax like store queue2 please, and we'll get the same options we know and love. Or instead, we can use the update key. The update window is still separated by possible presets and queues that we could update. On the queue side, it will specify the sequence, queue number, and also the part. We still have the options to update either original or new content, and we can certainly store a queue only if we want. I'm just going to touch this queue here, and we're updated. We can also still load a queue into the fixture sheet for editing by hitting Edit Queue and the number. If the queue has multiple parts, you don't have to be specific about what part you want to edit because all the parts will be loaded into the fixture sheet. To then work on a particular part, just change which one you're looking at with the dropdown at the top of the sheet. And when you're happy with your edits, hit Update. That was the basic overview of sequences on MA3. We didn't even start to talk about copying, inserting, or deleting queues, anything that would affect the tracking of our sequence. I want to cover everything related to tracking in the next video. See you there.